Eque erantibus ut in Deum, imposit redivit sine, veri papis tuae veneris venis, et acundi qui Christiane professione ci sento, et ida respondere, quia rupt iniquitas sunt nomine, et eque sunt apta sectari. Perdona nostra Chiesa in Christum redemptum, quid et in vita et regnati in unicatus Spiritus Sanctae, per omnia saecula saecula.
Amen.
Et sit et est via de Petri apostoli, Arisini et sempre vos tambam, ad demas et carinius ascinere vos, ad carnamibus desideris, quae militant adversus animi, anversatiem vestram intelligentes adeptes, bonam ut in eo, quod et frant deo dis tambam te malpaturibus, est bonis operibus vos transferontas, glorificem deum in die visitationes. Subiecti isidore escote omnis humane, in creatore propere deni, sire regi quasi procedentis, sire ducibus, in tantam ad eolissus ad dignitam, malfactorum larendero bodono, qui erse est voluntas Dei, ut bene pacientes, obtuncere faciatis, in prudentiam omnium ignorantiam, quasi liber et non quasi, valiam valentes malitiae libertate, sed sicut servi Dei, omnes honorate, fraternitatem dirigite, Deo dimete regem autoritate, servis subitum esto in omnitim timore Dominis, non tantum vobis et modestis, sed etiam dispotis, et est in gratia in Christo Jesu Domine nostro. Alleluia, alleluia, redemption eis Dominus populus suo. Alleluia, o corte vati Christum, et presugere amor Christ, et intra in gloria et in gloria sum. Amen.
Well, dear friends, just maybe a few reflections here concerning the feast days. It was on Friday, May the 1st, we had the feast of the great Saint Joseph the Worker. And so we hope that the fathers and the husbands in our parishes all across the country, of course, we hope that they took great consolation in the fact that the carpenter, the great Saint Joseph, will certainly bless them in their endeavors during this difficult time. It's also true that on Friday, our country was reconsecrated to our Blessed Mother by the Catholic bishops of the country, and we are proud of that. We're happy to hear news like that. Yesterday, it was May the 2nd, it was the feast of the great Saint Athanasius, who is the patron saint of the chapel here in San Jose. And the great Saint Athanasius, whose picture is up there at the top of the altar on the right, it would be your left, that picture there represents a man who was not very popular. He was a faithful Catholic bishop, and all of his fellow bishops said that he was wrong, including the Pope for a while, said that the great Athanasius was wrong. Remember the fight against Arianism. We are reminded about the great Archbishop, the founder of our religious order, Archbishop Marcel Lefebvre. Maybe one day, hopefully one day soon, it will be recognized the same. Also, yesterday, May the 2nd, was the first Saturday of the month, and we would extend that beautiful greetings or a happy month of May, especially to the good mothers of the parish and all the women and all the ladies. Month of May is a beautiful month in honor of Our Lady. Today, then, is the third Sunday after Easter. The epistle is taken from 1 Peter chapter 2. Dearly beloved, I beseech you as strangers and pilgrims to refrain yourselves from carnal desires, which war against the soul, having your conversation good among the Gentiles, that whereas they speak against you as evildoers, they may, by the good works which they shall behold in you, glorify God in the day of the visitation. Be you subject, therefore, to every human creature for God's sake, whether it be to the king as excelling, or to the governors as sent by him for the punishment of evildoers, or for the praise of the good. For so is the will of God, that by doing well you may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men, as free and as not yet making liberty a cloak for malice, but as the servants of God, honor all men. Love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the king. Servants, be subject to your masters with all fear, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the forward, for this is thanksworthy in Jesus Christ our Lord. You may stand for the Holy Gospel, taken from St. John chapter 16. At that time Jesus said to his disciples, "A little while and you shall not see me, and again a little while and you shall see me, because I go to the Father." Then some of his disciples said one to another, "What is this that he saith to us? A little while and you shall not see me, and again a little while and you shall see me, because I go to the Father." They said therefore, "What is this that he saith a little while? We know not what he speaks." And Jesus knew that what they had in mind to ask him, and he said to them, "Of this do you inquire among yourselves, because I said a little while, and you shall not see me, and again a little while and you shall see me. Amen, amen, I say to you, that you shall lament and weep, but the world shall rejoice, and you shall be made sorrowful, but your sorrow shall be turned into joy. A woman, when she is in labor, hath sorrow because her hour is come. But when she hath brought forth the child, she remembers no more the anguish, for the joy that a man is born into the world. So also you now indeed have sorrow, but I will see you again, and your heart shall rejoice, and your joy no man shall take from you." Thus far are the words of the Holy Gospel. You can see. A little while, and you shall see. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Well, dear friends, it was about 500 years ago now, in the country of England, that there lived an outstanding man, an outstanding statesman. His name was Thomas More. He's the patron of our school. Is up there on top of the altar. Thomas More was in a very high position. He was Chancellor of England, which means, you might say, he was the king's right-hand man. The king trusted his judgment, and the king truly honored Thomas More. But when King Henry VIII sinfully decided to get rid of his first wife and to marry Anne Boleyn, Thomas More objected, because he knew the doctrine of marriage, the indissolubility of matrimony. When the couple on the altar, the day they are wedded, they say, "Until death do we part." And furthermore, when the king, King Henry, made himself head of the Church of England, that is when Thomas More refused to accept him as such as well, because he knew that only the successor of Peter, the Holy Father, is the head of the Church. For this, Thomas More was thrown into prison, into the Tower of London. And the king will try to change Thomas More's mind. First, what the king does is he sends More's oldest daughter, who goes and says to her father, please change your mind. Please, do whatever it takes. We love you. We don't want to see you in this prison. Thomas More objected. And finally, the king sent even Thomas More's own wife. She came into the prison cell crying. She said, oh, Thomas, why don't you just deny the faith and free yourself from this filthy prison? You could spend many more happy years with me and your daughters. But looking at her, More put this question to his wife. He said, dear, how long do you think I have to live in this world? And she said, perhaps 20 years. Then, putting his arm around his wife, More said, my dear, 20 years, or even 100 years, is but a little while compared to the millions of years of eternity. Do you want me to trade 20 years of this life for the millions of years of eternity? 20 years is but a little while. After that, we will be happy forever. Those were the words of the great St. Thomas More. Thomas More went to death. He was a man of principles. He was a man of principles. On the day that he died, the story is that he put his head on the block upon which he would be martyred. And then when he put his head on the block, he took his beard and pushed his beard to the side and said to the executioners, don't harm this beard. It has not done any treason. So you see, even in the moment of death, our great saints are joyful. Thomas More was canonized in the year 1935 by Pius XI. But I begin the sermon with that story because even more, the pressure is how much he loved his wife and his daughters and how much he wanted to live, which was evident. He would not trade all of eternity for this little while. Yes, my dear friends, I think of a father who's driving his car. And you know, the kids are in the back seat and they're on a trip, let's say a long road trip. And the kids keep saying one after another, are we there yet? Are we there yet? And parents, I know, have heard this countless times. Are we there yet? And the father driving the car will simply say over and over, no, not there yet. Just a little while longer. It is like that our Lord speaks to us today in the Gospels. He is telling us, yet a little while, and you shall not see me. Because he is referring to his crucifixion and his burial that is coming. And then he says, again, a little while, and you shall see me. There, he is referring to his glorious resurrection. On this Sunday, which we might title the sermon, A Little While, we would do well to think about the meaning of life. Yes, everything lasts a little while in this world. Riches last for a little while. So does poverty. So does health and sickness, suffering and joy, even smiles and tears last for a little while. You can't hold a smile all day, even though you might try, and you certainly can't cry all day. The tear ducts will dry up. Misunderstanding and affection, temptations, and even quiet moments, all of them have one thing in common in this world. They will last but for a little while. Yes, even the things of this world that seem like they last for a long time. I think of the pyramids of Egypt. I think of the great mountains. That we can say, Father, that they last for a long time. Well, I suppose you're right if you're measuring from this world. But if you look from the world of eternity, the pyramids of old and the mountains, they are here just for a little while. Sometimes it might even seem that temptations and sufferings last for a long time. But no, those too. They only last but a lifetime. And even a lifetime is in the blink of an eye, it is over. It lasts but for a little while. Even sin, which captivates so many people every day in this world, sin with all of its glamour, its pleasures, its so-called satisfactions, it may last for an hour. It may last but for a brief minute, whatever pleasures, sinful pleasures we're talking about. But one thing they have in common, all those sins, that they will last for a little. because you cashed in all of eternity for that sin. Even separation lasted for a little while. We think of loved ones who have to move away from home. I think of a soldier who goes off to war. How sad it is, separation, when a neighbor moves out of the neighborhood, when a graduating class says so long to each other. But in those moments, we should remember the truth of the words of our Lord in today's gospel. They lasted for a little while. There's the famous story of Sullivan Bellew, who was a soldier in the Great Civil War. He wrote home to his wife before the Battle of Bull Run. It was July 14, 1862. And Sullivan Bellew wrote these words to his wife, whose name was Sarah. He said at the end of the letter, "Sarah, do not mourn me dead. Think I am gone, and simply wait for me, for we shall meet again." Sullivan Bellew was killed a week after writing that letter, the Battle of Bull Run, the first battle of Bull Run. So even death, as that man says, is but a temporary thing. Wait for me. It might even be a long life of waiting. We wait all the time for good things. Kids count down the days till Christmas, or to a birthday, or to a party. How quickly those days pass. And then when they pass, we say, where has it gone? The joys of Christmas and the holidays, the sweet memories of childhood, yes, even the memories of our whole lifetime. They are passing so quick like the setting of the sun. But we should remember the words of the psalmist, who says that to the Lord a day is but 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is but a day. Can we seriously reflect then this Sunday? Really reflect upon our life. All the hours of our days, they are so quickly fleeting. Whether these be hours of joy or hours of grief, hours of sadness and tears, or even hours of suffering. How many poor people now in the hospitals all over the world are dying of old age or cancer? People who got into awful car accidents and they're dealing with recovery slowly. People who are paralyzed, laying in a hospital bed now for some 40 years. What about those people? May God bless their sufferings. And if they ever lose heart, may they always remember these words, but a little while, but a little while. Indeed, we are all like that little kid in the back seat of the car, so eager to arrive at our destinies. We might also pause and reflect on the words of our Lord at the end of the gospel, when he said that your joy no man shall take from you. There's no one more joyful than a Catholic. There's so many great stories of our saints and how joyful they were. I'll give you one example, and I hope I don't get in trouble for this example. But if I do, I just say it wasn't me who said this. But it was the great St. Francis de Sales, who lived in the 1600s. St. Francis was known for being quite a comic, even from the pulpit sometimes. And one day, St. Francis de Sales mounted the pulpit of his church and delivered this story. And he said that this story was something that was very important, and that the people, the men of the parish, and especially the wives, should listen to. He said, all of us know what it means to be contradictory. He said, for instance, I'll give you an example. A lot of the men of the parish, he said, have contradictory wives. Wives that are always contradicting their husbands. He said, for instance, one man might say, recalling the evening, last evening's events, that such and such occurred at 6 p.m. in the evening. And then his wife chimes in and says, oh no, dear, it was 5 minutes before 6 that it occurred. St. Francis goes on to say, you know this kind of person. Well, it so happened that that contradictory wife, one day she fell into a river and she drowned. And the poor husband decided to drag that river in order to find her body. And starting at the point where she fell in, the story goes that he went upstream looking for her body. And all of his friends said, what are you doing? The stream is flowing that way. Surely her body will be carried down the river. To which the man replied to his friends, you don't know my wife. She is so opposite, he said, that I'm sure that even her dead body will somehow find a way to go upstream. He said this story, and I'm sure he got some giggles, and that story was said over almost 400 years ago. And you think about how we tell these stories over and over. It is also true that the great St. Francis de Sales had people who were making false rumors about him. We have that going on even in the media right now. So-called Catholic press giving false stories. What did Francis de Sales say? He said that one time he heard rumors being said about his good name, to which he simply replied to the people. He said, I hear that you have been clipping away at my beard, but don't worry, God will somehow allow it to grow back again. So yes, it's true, we can compare even these foolish statements made in order to attack a church, to attack a priest, or to attack one's good reputation. That is foolish talk. And it will one day be revealed in the light of grace at the end of the world. The second coming will shed light on all those falsehoods. So let us think then as we end the joys of the saints. No one can take your joy from you, our Lord says. I think of the martyrs. I think of all those great saints, men, women, and children. They went through so many tortures. Don't mean to be graphic, but they had their eyes gouged out. They had their teeth knocked out. They had their ears cut off, their hands and their feet amputated inch by inch. Some of them were burned alive, others were dragged by wild animals. Some were covered and crushed with stones. Some had nails pierced through them. All these tortures, the martyrs, through all the ages of the church, all those martyrs met those joys, met those sufferings with joy in their heart. It is one of the paradoxes of Christianity. It is an apparent contradiction that somehow out of agony and pain would still come true joy and happiness. In fact, it's a true condition of the Christian faith that joy must come in sacrifice. It sounds like a contradiction. You have to give up in order to get it. You have to suffer in order to enjoy. You have to face your pain in order to win. We always say to the kids in the sports, no pain, no gain. It is the same mentality, and we live that in our Catholic faith every single day. Every temptation that comes, every trial, every cross, every heartache that happens, even what we're going through right now, this COVID-19 nonsense, it is all the same. From it, all this suffering, from all this delay, we will only reap greater joy. But that will be to the Christian. To the man without the faith, he will despair. He will turn in bitterness and self-destruction. But that is not our right. And we can finally end with the example given by our Lord himself. Our Lord must have a tender spot for the mothers, for the good women who bring children into this world. Because in the gospel today, he uses the analogy of a woman who goes into labor. He says that when her time has come, and her time to deliver the child is drawing near. Her moment of suffering comes. But then he says, in just a little while, all of her pain, 9 months, sicknesses, the worries, perhaps the depression, all those sufferings are but nothing for the joy that a little child has been born into this world. So with those words then, may we, this month of May and next Sunday is Mother's Day, so give the kids a time of warning to prepare. May we all of us reflect on that beautiful analogy that, yes, through motherhood, a little one is brought into this world, conceived and reared in pain and suffering, but then that joy of a child being born, all that time can be compared to the little time that we spend in this life preparing for eternity. St. Peter, 1 Peter chapter verse 5 says, and after you have suffered a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, confirm, and strengthen you. So may God bless you on this third Sunday after Easter, and may you continue to suffer, yes, but for a little while. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.
Prayer for the wounded, Father, and
And it's good.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Mother of mercy, our life, our sweetness, and our hope. To thee do we cry, brothers, children of Eve. To thee do the sun of our sighs, mourning and weeping this valley of tears. Turn in those graces and take up thy eyes, mercy towards us. And after this, our exiles, show unto us the blessed fruit of thy womb, Jesus. O Holy Mother, sweet Virgin Mary, that we may be made worthy of the promises of Christ.
Pray, O God, that we may be our strength of them, faith upon thy people of Christ. And through the intercession of the glorious and immaculate Virgin Mary, Mother of God, of blessed Joseph, her spouse, of thy holy apostles, Peter and Paul, and all the saints, and do thou mercifully and graciously give the prayers which we pour forth for the conversion of sinners, and for the freedom and the exaltation of our holy Mother Church, in the same Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Saint Michael, the Archangel,
defend us in battle. Be safeguard against the wicked and snares of the devil. Be kind and restrain him while we pray. And do thou, Prince of the heavenly host, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all the evil spirits who prowl about the world seeking the ruin of souls. Have mercy on us. Have mercy on us. Have mercy on us.